today, and I have a new member who is, and his name is Ted Welches. Just joined us today, so thank you. Also, I wanted today to make sure to remind everybody to look at the new schedule that you have on your places. This schedule includes what's left of May and all of our April topics, which will all be about candidates and where they are and what they're doing. So we would like to make sure to remind you to look at the April candidates. We have a whole bunch of them for the whole month, plus a couple that are going to come in April. So just to let you know, this is what we have. And without further ado, I will introduce. I will have Kelly Books, who is our ODOT Region 1 meeting person, and also speaker number 2, which will be David Kim, who is an ODOT Area West manager. Thank you.
Contract payments was actually 2010. We're pretty proud of that, and one of the reasons why we're so proud of that is because those So it gives you a sense of why we ended up with those kind of jobs numbers. The American Recovery and Reinvestment Act, that was the federal stimulus program, contributed more than $470 million to the Oregon economy just in transportation projects. Another thing, this changed just a little bit at ODOT in the past 10, 15 years, as we're not just a highway agency anymore. We do a lot of different types of projects. So our Connect Oregon program, for example, we're now on the fourth round of Connect 4 grants. Those are lottery-backed bonds, and they fund non-road multimodal improvements, rail, marine, port. And so there have been 31 of those so far in Region 1 that have been funded, those kinds of projects. And right now, the regions are reviewing the current applicants, and they will award those projects later on this summer. We also have a number of different grant programs which relate to either trail improvements, bike and pedestrian facilities, and some of those are mentioned up here on this slide. Flex funds, that's a relatively new program which has funded different projects in Washington County as well. So now I just want to talk just a little bit about different sources of money and where those sources are headed. And you can kind of tell by the fact that I did that, maybe where they're headed. The Jobs and Transportation Act, that was House Bill 2001, and it was passed by the 2009 legislature. And it provided funding for 37 specific highway projects, nine projects, just in Region 1. And the way that it funded those projects, it raised the gas tax by 6 cents, and that went into effect January of last year. And I just have this little pie chart here to show that the state gets 50% of that revenue that was generated. The rest is split between cities and counties. This is also a little hard to see, and David has this same map later, and he'll talk about it in more detail. But I just want to highlight a few of the Jobs and Transportation Act projects that I thought y'all might be interested in, and flag kind of those big dollar amounts. So there's three on US 26. There's the Glencoe Road project, which is $32 million. Chute Road or Brookwood, $45 million. And 185th to Cornell Road, that's $20 million. I'm sure you guys are very familiar with that one. And then you can also see I-5-205 interchange, the Selwood Bridge. We have a 257th interchange on I-84, the Sunrise Project, and then this down here is the Oregon City Jug Handle Project. So what was different about JTA than any of the OTIA packages is there was this funding increase, right? And the legislature said, these are the projects we want you to work on. So those JTA funds were dedicated through that legislation to these specific projects in Region 1. So this is ODOT's capital program. And I'm just going to walk through what these different big color blocks are. So down here, the big blue one, that's our STIP program. So the State Transportation Investment Program. And that is the gas tax money, the both state and federal, that we receive, our driver fees, all of that. It's kind of our base source of capital money for the state transportation system. And you can see that source of money has been going down for some time. People are actually driving a little bit less than they used to. So that has been going down. Then you see those OTIA packages I was talking to you about. There's OTIA 1 and 2 and OTIA 3. And so we got some more money to do a lot of projects. And then you have Connect Oregon, I talked about that, and ARA, that federal stimulus program, and the Jobs and Transportation Act. And what you can see is that all of that funding combined peaked about 2009, 2010, which coincides with that construction contract payment slide that I showed you as well. And we are now kind of going down. So we're doing these projects, and we'll go back here because there are no new kind of funding packages on the horizon now. And what that means for us is you'll see, aside from those Jobs and Transportation Act projects that were included in the bill, we focus more on preservation and maintenance and operations and less on modernization. bonding those resources. So we get the resources, we bond out so that we can go ahead and deliver those projects in the short term, which means we have to pay off those projects in the long term. So that is our debt service going into 2016. There's another reason why the mountain chart, as they call it, looks the way that it looks. And that is because there's a great deal of uncertainty at the federal level right now with respect to transportation funding. So there's a six-year surface transportation reauthorization bill, which is now on about its ninth extension. And there's a lot of talk in D.C. about, well, maybe we should just make it so that the Highway Trust Fund, which is where all the federal gas tax dollars go, that the Highway Trust Fund should be able to pay for all our surface transportation programs, and we shouldn't be adding more money to it, right? It needs to be self-sufficient. Well, if you take our programs, and you would essentially have to cut it by 30%. If we're only going to spend what goes into the Highway Trust Fund instead of Congress adding more to the pot, it's a 30% cut for Oregon. So that's just something we have to think about if we're planning conservatively for the future, is the fact that that may be our funding reality moving forward. So what does this mean for us? This is a chart of our pavement conditions as they are right now. And we're actually in fairly good shape. You guys might disagree sometimes when you're out driving around. But we are doing, in 2010, we had just above 85% fair or better pavement. And part of that was we made a series of investments with those stimulus dollars to do some repair. But going forward, we expect those pavement conditions to decline. When people kept talking to me about fair and better pavement, I wanted to know what that meant. So I pulled this little slide together to show what good pavement looks like, what we mean. Fair, and then poor, and then very poor, which is really rutted. Bridge conditions. So we've done a lot of work on our bridges. We've made a lot of headway. But we still have some more work to do. The largest portion of our bridges were built prior to 1970. 1,500 of our bridges are going to be reaching the end of their design life by 2020. And then 27% of these are 1 point away from being structurally deficient. We also have a lot of slides and rock fall repair needs throughout the region. Our current funding of $7.4 million per year means it would take us about 25 years just to address our immediate need sites. Culverts, we have a fair number of those. 31% of our assessed culverts are in poor or critical condition, and the gap between our needs and the funding we have to repair them is $77 million a year. This goes back to that other need. So it's kind of hard for me to capture, okay, what's the unmet need for bikes and peds? And I just picked the example of our Transportation Enhancement Grant Program. So every other year when we put that grant opportunity out, we receive requests for 500 to 700% of what we can fund. So there's a lot of folks interested in it, and it's not, we can't meet all their needs. So since money doesn't grow on trees, well, this graphic, we have to find ways to do what we need to do for less. And we have some strategies that we're implementing moving forward to do that. One of them is to focus our maintenance and preservation dollars on really doing maintenance and preservation and doing it as early as we can. So every dollar that we spend improving pavement when it's in fair or better condition actually saves us more money down the road. So we'd have to spend $3 to $5 if we wait until it gets in poor or worse condition, and then $8 to $12 if we wait until we have to rebuild the entire road. So it just makes more sense when we can do it to get out there and do that early repair work so we can save money down the road. We also need to focus on our bridges, and we need to protect those high-value coastal, historic, major river crossings by acting before cost becomes prohibitive. We want to use practical design, and I don't know if y'all are familiar with that term, and David could actually explain it much better than I do, but you know, practical design is really trying to do not the minimum, but what time on bridge preventative maintenance and get better at that. Another thing you'll hear us say, and you might hear David talk about it during his presentation, something called right-sizing our projects. It's practical design, what I just mentioned. There's been a couple examples of that just in Washington County. So the Glencoe Road interchange that I mentioned on the Jobs and Transportation Act, that was originally a $70 million project. And the legislature didn't have $70 million to give. They had about half that. So we took a look and figured out, all right, well, what kind of design changes can we make that still solve the issues that we have and deliver the project for the amount of resources we have available? And that's exactly what's happening. Another one, which I know is near and dear to all of your hearts, is Highway 217. So on the horizon, finding the resources we would need to add an additional lane it's extremely expensive. And so no one wants to wait that long to see any improvements in operations out there. So we've been really doubling down and focusing on those intelligent transportation solutions, shoulder widening, whatever we can do, working with our local and regional elected officials so that we can start to make some gains and see better operations on that corridor. So looking ahead, in the short term, we are making our budget stretch further by focusing on preservation and maintenance and getting more out of our existing system. I should also say that our agency itself is shrinking by, I think it's approximately 5%. Over the next 5 years. And in the long term, we're going to need to continue coming out and talking with you guys and our other partners around the region about what are our priorities, what do we want to focus on. And that is it for me. And I'll come back up at the end and answer questions, but I want to hand it over to David so he can talk through more specifics about Washington County.
Jackson School Road, the ag grade intersection, it was very risky to make those left turns. We constructed a new restripe the southbound direction, and this summer we're going to come back and repave that northerly section of the highway. And that was for $35 million. So a lot of these projects were funded in part with the OTIA programs that Kelly talked about earlier. Then came along in 2008-2009 ARRA, the American Reinvestment and Recovery Act. That was a federal stimulus program. Oregon received $334 million just for transportation. And of that, $100 million went to local agencies. And that took us about 3 years to deliver. This map shows the distribution of the federal stimulus dollars as it relates to transportation. You can see there were a lot in the Portland metropolitan area. As I mentioned earlier, a lot of the funding was passed through, so of the $100 million, we provided funding to Washington County and various cities throughout the county. The unique thing about federal stimulus dollars is that the federal government wanted jobs now, and so we looked at low-hanging fruit. What can we deliver quickly and get out there? And so what you see is a lot of easy, quick projects. We did a lot of urban-rural paving. You'll notice that about this time frame, a bunch of those yellow flashing left-turn arrows popped up. A substantial portion of that was funded with federal stimulus dollars. We were able to work with the county to install a lot of the head countdown heads, so when you're at a crosswalk, instead of the walk, don't walk, you have a timer that lets you know how much time you have to cross the roadway. And we did a lot of signal equipment upgrades, so now a lot of these signals talk with one another, so when you're driving down a road, you don't get stopped at every red light, but it's adaptive technology where each controller will say, I just turned green, so the signal down. The next signal needs to change green in 20 seconds because there's cars coming. And for ODOT, what we funded was I had cable barrier installed from North Plains out to 185th. We've had a number of bad crossover crashes, and there was an opportunity to improve safety, so we got that added onto the project. And then I also had a lot of sign upgrades. There's new federal standards that require larger signs and bigger lettering as the population ages. So we're working within ODOT to get as many of the highway signs upgraded as we can. So today at ODOT, Kelly mentioned the STIP program, and that primarily entails our capital improvement program, really focuses on safety, preservation, paving, and operations like signal upgrades and cameras. And so I'll talk about the STIP, and then I'll talk about the Jobs and Transportation Act. So in the next 5 years, these are all the projects that I have planned in Washington County. And they're safety projects. This totals about $170 million through 2016. Preservation projects. I have about 7 highway preservation projects. The most recent one that was completed was the North Plains to 185th. This summer, I'm going to have from Sylvan Hill to the tunnels. That's going to be repaved. And then I'm going to have the north section of Oregon 217 repaved. So basically by 2014, from North Plains to the tunnels, you should have pretty good pavement condition. And then I'm going to have all of 217 repaved next summer. And then I have a section of roadway from Tualatin to Sherwood on 99W Pacific Highway that's also going to get repaved. And then we also recently repaved I-5 in both directions between Wilsonville and 205. For safety projects, I have 7 safety projects in Washington County. Several of them are on 99W, and then I have several on TP Highway out at 185th and 192nd. We're seeing a lot of crashes out there. And so the way our safety program works is we look at the history, and we look at where the most severe accidents are and where the most frequent accidents are, and then we look at the cause of those accidents, and then we look at ways to engineer projects that's going to improve the safety or reduce the severity of crashes that occur. Operations projects, I have operations projects all throughout the county, and so I didn't really provide a map of that, but typically our operations projects consist of upgrading signals, putting in LED lights, upgrading the controllers so they can talk to one another. We're going to have more flashing yellow left turns installed. We have cameras, we have over 200 cameras statewide. My next camera section is going to be in Sherwood. I got about 5 cameras that are going to be installed in Sherwood on Pacific Highway. The benefit of these cameras is that we have staff, a dispatch center at our ODOT headquarters that looks at all the cameras, monitor the traffic, and if the traffic stopped, they will move the camera to see what the issue is, whether it's an accident or a disabled motorist. And as Kelly mentioned earlier, we'll get an incident responder out there to get that vehicle out of harm's way and help them, whether it's a flat tire or providing them with gas. We have a bunch of variable message signs on the state highways. You're going to see more of those. Even on the arterials now, we're looking at installing a bunch of variable message signs on some of the arterials so the drivers can make decisions before they get on the highway. If there's a crash on 217, we're going to have a sign on the arterial that says crash on 217. You may want to take a different route if there's a viable different route. Ramp meters, I know there's been a lot of debate about ramp meters, but we'll be upgrading ramp meter technology. They will start talking with one another as well. And then, as I mentioned earlier, just installing more cameras. The beauty of these cameras is they're available to everybody, the news media and yourselves. So if you're going to go on a trip, whether up to the mountain or just to the coast, you can look at the cameras and look at the weather conditions and get a sense of whether you need to take your tire chains or whether the traffic's flowing smoothly or you might want to wait a little bit before you leave the home. So I talked about the STIP, and that was basically our capital programs, the projects I just went through. The JTA is the Jobs and Transportation Act. As Kelly alluded earlier, 6-cent increase, it translates to about $300 million a year. Half of that's going to cities and counties, the other half's going to ODOT. In statewide, there was about $900 million of specific projects that the legislature identified. In Washington County, we were able to receive 108 of that. Three of those projects were on Sunset Highway, and one's underway right now in construction. And then we have the one at I-5 northbound where we extended the auxiliary lane and added a additional lane on the ramp to 205. We've seen significant improvements with just those two projects that are complete or underway. Here's the I-5 at 205. We added an extra lane, or extended an extra lane, so cars would have to reduce the number of times they'd have to change lanes. We also upgraded the signs. And that project took about 6 months to complete. The 185th to Cornell, I know many of you drive Sunset Highway, that project's underway right now. I expect that project will be completed in July of this year. In the westbound direction, all they have left to do is final paving. And in the eastbound direction, they still have to put in the media filter drain. One of the requirements of ODOT is that we have to treat all the water that runs off our highways. We don't just have to treat it, but we have to detain it. We have to hold it and then release it. Hold it, treat it, and then release it so we don't cause flooding downstream. And so there's a special media filter system that we installed that lines basically each side of the highway. And a contractor needs dry weather in order to be able to install that. And that's why you see all those big pipes in the eastbound direction. They're all waiting to get that work underway. The Glencoe Interchange Project is a $32 million project that the legislature provided. As Kelly mentioned earlier, we're using practical design or right-sizing this project. This project for a full interchange build-out would have cost about $70 million. What we decided to do is, what was really the problem with this interchange? And the problem was that cars were backing up on the highway, trying to get either into North Plains or go down to Hillsboro. So this project's really what it does is, it's going to raise the overpass. Currently it's two lanes, we're gonna make it four lanes, and we're gonna lengthen and widen this ramp, and we're gonna lengthen and widen this ramp. And that's really gonna address the major flows. And we're able to design a project to meet this budget. And the bid package for this project is actually heading down to Salem today. The bid opening will be in May. We'll probably start seeing construction in July of this year. barriers is transportation, and we want to ensure that transportation won't be a barrier to those trade sector jobs, and really look at making the land attractive for development, specifically industrial development. Here's a schedule for the Brookwood Parkway, our interchange project. We're looking at that project. It'll go to construction next summer, and it'll take about 2.5 years to build. This is another partnership project with Washington County and the city of Hillsboro. And then beyond so I've just gone through the list of capital projects and the Jobs and Transportation Act projects. So beyond 2017, what's the outlook? Well, we have the STIP, and that'll still be there. So our focus is really going to be on safety, operations, and maintenance. And we're currently underway and starting to identify projects for 2017 and 2018. That's how far out we plan when we go to design projects. And then I have $0 for modernization. A lot of the money that we would have had for modernization today is going back to repay the debt, the loans that we borrowed, the bonds that Kelly mentioned earlier, the OTIA program. There was no new money for that. We're having to use gas tax money to repay those bonds, so there really isn't anything. And I think the takeaway for me is that in Washington County, we did a really good job of planning. If we look at the projects that were designed and are in the pipeline, we did a lot of planning with that. And I know that I think at your last week's meeting, you had Metro here talk about TV Highway Corridor Plan. The only project that I have in the books right now that we've identified but does not have any funding is the continued widening of Sunset Highway from 185th out to Ponias Pass Road. That's the only major project I have in terms of a plan. There's a lot of other planning underway, but until we get another major funding source, it's really just going to be maintaining the existing infrastructure we have and optimizing the system through various operational projects. You can get additional information on our website for each specific project you want to see, or if you have a particular question, you can send an email to Ask ODOT, and they have a 5-day turnaround time to respond back to you. One note, on my 185th to Cornell project, at Bronson, we had to build a brand new retaining wall. And so as a contractor came in there, they had to clear and grub the area. We had a couple of trees and large bushes and blackberries. One of the things I mentioned earlier is we're an agency that's sensitive to the environment. And our my construction office cordoned off this area, and you see a couple of blue flags. One of the blue flags was to ensure that plant there would not be disturbed. But this blue flag here, they identified a duck. And so they actually had the contractor avoid the area until the chicks were born, and then were able to resume work in the area. And we do have other users of the highway system, and we're very sensitive to that. With that, that concludes our presentation. We'll take any questions you may have.
So we do have microphones on both sides of the room, so feel free to come and we'll alternate.
Patrick Wheeler, Portman. When they built the Trans-Canadian Highway, it was 18 months to build 1,800 miles. And it's been 2.5 years, as far as I can tell, for an extra half mile from Bethany Boulevard to 185th. Why does it take so damn long to get something built?
Good question. So for the 185th to Cornell project, we could... To the average person, you think you just slap on some additional pavement and you're done. The unique thing about 185th to Cornell was, one, we had to accommodate traffic two lanes in both directions, and the contractor needed room on the shoulder. So the way that we staged the project was we had to actually widen the highway to the inside, reconstruct the shoulder to accommodate cars. You can't just throw pavement on, you have to build the base. Do that. Also construct the retaining walls along Bronson Creek there, and then install this media filter drain. One of the challenges that we faced was, if you recall back in the winter and spring of 2000, or winter of 2010, spring of 2011, we had a very, very wet winter. A lot of our projects are very weather dependent, specifically with water and temperature. And so in the winter months, the contractor shuts down. It's very inefficient for them to send one crew out for a week and then wait for it to rain. a lot of the earthwork we do is digging up the earth, bringing earth, dirt in or hauling dirt away, and when it's wet, it's really muddy. In fact, when we went back in 2011 to resume work, the soils under the ground were so wet that we had to actually go back and get more money to put in rock. And as we progressed into the late summer of 2011, the saturation levels started to go down. We didn't need as much rock. So we encountered some wet weather conditions that caused some delay, the construction of the retaining walls, and then the construction of the median. If you look at the I-5 job, that was done in about 6 months because they had enough room on the shoulder. They could just put a barrier in there and work safely. In the case of Sunset Highway, they don't have that extra space, and we have to provide a safe place for the traveling public and also the workers. So that's why it's taken so long. I do appreciate everybody's patience. I did get a lot of calls from the public about why it's taking so long. And I have to go into more detail, but in the case of Sunset Highway, it's a little unique. But we want to make sure that it's safe for our workers and for the traveling public.
Thank you very much. Sobering when you hit the ball in 2017, and I think Charlie pointed out it was like 77 million in unmet needs in just one category. What is going to be the next revenue source, especially considering that with the price of gas and electric vehicles, there's going to be less per capita gasoline consumption?
Well, that's a good question. And I think, I mean, frankly, right now it sort of begs that question, right? So what's, if you have more needs than you can fund, where are you going to find the money to do those things? And, you know, the short answer is really from our perspective right now, we know there are needs. We know that will be a discussion in the 2013 legislature for specific projects. In terms of new sources, so road user fees, that kind of thing, there has been a lot of work that ODOT has done to kind of investigate that issue and work on that issue, and there have been discussions in the legislature about it. At this point, though, there's nothing right now that's about to move forward at this stage, but I think you'll continue to hear us kind of talk about that moving forward.
Bill Corver.
I can just add one more thing. And Oregon was a leader in implementing the gas tax across the country, and we know that the gas tax is not a sustainable revenue source. And Oregon is a leader now in exploring new revenue sources, and one is vehicle miles traveled technology, where it equally, whether you drive a electric vehicle or a hybrid or gas, you may be looking at paying by the miles that you drive. And so that's something that we're exploring. We did a test pilot. There's a lot of interest here in Oregon and across the country. And so that we're looking at a sustainable funding source that will evenly tax everybody that uses the roadways fairly.
I'm a Bill Corver, forum member. Thanks for coming in. Companion question, in not talking about the revenue source, but about the transportation itself. You know, you were talking about lighter vehicles. You got public transportation. You got the West Line. And I just kind of wondered, maybe, you know, because you think about this a lot, I was wondering maybe 20, 30 years down the road, kind of what we're looking at for the needs for transportation.
That's a good question. Also, you know what, and it's a big question, frankly, and I think part of that is why I ended on that note, that we're going to have, I think, a conversation amongst all of us about what we want our transportation system to look like. And I think we've heard pretty loud and clear that, you know, folks want options, they want choices. That's more than just roads. So I know Ben Pearson in the governor's office has been having some conversations about how do we find different sources of revenue to fund those non-road projects as well. And so I think moving forward, I think right now I think you should definitely kind of look at that no new capacity, no modernization kind of impact, and we need to then talk as a community about if that's okay with us or not. I think we're going to continue to grow. I know we're going to continue to grow. More people are going to need to use the system we already have. So, there will be increased congestion if we don't plan for the future.
So I know that we can't build our way out of congestion. And one of the things that our Transportation Commission is focused on is looking at other modes. And with the Connect Oregon program and with the Flex Funds program, they are looking at ramping up other modes of transportation. If you look at ODOT back in the 90s, we were primarily a highway agency. Now we're a multimodal agency. And so we want to ensure that we provide adequate funding to transit, bike, ped, and other programs to give people choices so that they're not just limited to using their vehicles.
Thank you.
Raymond, forum member. TV Highway is very busy. It's one of the most dangerous in the areas. In the area, it's and there are, the walk lights are only 17 seconds. Is there any plan for longer walk lights? And same situation on Cornell. It's maybe slightly less busy, but the 17 seconds just isn't long enough for someone who moves slowly. Is that going to change?
Certainly, if you have a specific intersection that you're concerned about, we can certainly have our traffic engineers go out and take a look. We do want to provide adequate timing for pedestrians to cross the roadways. We know that Cornell is actually a Washington County facility, but TV Highway is a state highway, and it is very congested. We have partnered with Metro, Washington County, the cities of Beaverton, and Hillsboro to look at what the future of TV Highway is going to look like. Is it going to be a highway, or is it going to be something else that keeps it where it is today, and we look at just operational improvements and improving safety? I had a slide up earlier that showed safety projects, and we do have concerns at 185th and 192nd as it relates to pedestrians and as it relates to cars, and so we're looking at that. There's a balance between keeping traffic moving and safety, and certainly if there's certain intersections that you're very concerned about, we'd be more than happy to take a look at them.
I live just off 198th, which is also a busy street, and speed limit's 35, but people seem to think it should be 50, and it's so... I go from a busy street to TV Highway, and it's kind of scary sometimes.
Is 198 a signalized intersection?
I beg your pardon?
Does 198 have a light?
Yes.
Says, okay, I'll have somebody go out and take a look to see if we can add some additional time to get my slide.
One quick follow-up on your safety point. So David earlier when he was talking about the safety projects we have, I mean, that's our engineering approach. That's how we think we can configure the road a little bit differently to make it safer. That's something we'd like to do. But that's only one of the E's that people talk about in safety. There's engineering, education, enforcement, and emergency response. And enforcement's key when you talk about the speed limit. And so it's we work with our partners to kind of, and everyone's got constrained resources, but kind of backing up sort of those speed limits with enforcement is usually a really effective tool.
And I just had one more thing. On TV Highway at 178, we had a number of children that were hit several years ago, and ODOT installed the rapid flashing beacon, and now today we have a signal, and that should be up and running here in the next couple of weeks.
Thank you. Thank you for being here today. My name is Jerry Arnold. Two questions. First one, for the last three decades, I think, Washington County and ODOT have discussed the intersection at Shoals Ferry and Beaverton Hillsdale Highway. Money has been allocated to that years and years and years, and I think there's $1 million every couple of years. Second question is, what's the role that ODOT plays in the Columbia River crossing?
I'll address the first question for Ocean Shoals, we are working with Washington County and Metro. I believe that Metro has provided some planning funds to look at ways to really improve the safety of that intersection. It is a nasty, nasty intersection. And so we're following Washington County's lead. ODOT's involvement is really that there's a small section there that's ODOT's jurisdiction. But we're really going to look at what the county desires and the residents of Washington County would like to see how that intersection configuration looks like. So I know that some funding has been provided to continue to work on the plan. And so we're just at the table listening to what the county and others would like to see.
And your question was, what role does ODOT play in the Columbia River Crossing? The Columbia River Crossing is a bi-state project. So it's Washington and ODOT. We're partners in that agency. So we'll all have resources, state resources, federal resources, and local revenues raised through tolls will be a part of that. So ODOT's definitely a part of that project.
Bill. Good morning. Lee Coleman, member of the forum. Highway 47 from Sunset Highway to Scappoose is in desperate need of widening, straightening, so that farmers from the interior, Yamhill County and Washington County and so on, can bring product to port at less cost. Ditto
much of our gas tax money after 2016 is going to be just paying off these bonds?
I should have a better answer, but I think, I mean, it's a significant portion of our budget at that point is bond repayment. I want to say 50%. That might not be right. Those I can get back to you on that. I think the important thing to remember about the debt repayment is it's real. We have to pay it off, but those were the choices that we made, was to invest in these projects and get them rolling. So it's not like we're just paying off, credit card debt from other things. I mean, we're paying off real projects that we decided as a state to invest in. But yeah, it's a significant portion of our budget, which is why our capital program reflects that change.
Just one quick comment.
Yeah.
I think Highway 47 from Vernonia to Plaskanai is the worst state highway in the state of Oregon. You're dangerous.
Yep. Okay.
Just a thought.
No, I'll definitely pass it. We don't like enough our force.
The situation you mentioned with funding from the state, where the legislature identified funding for a specific list of projects, is kind of unusual. I'm just wondering how the list that the legislature provided stacked up against priorities identified by the department through its own planning processes.
Yeah. It's a good question. I wasn't a part, it was before I came to the agency and I wasn't in that session. But we were an active participant in those discussions and worked with legislators to make sure they had all the information they needed from us about what the priorities are. So, I can't say, frankly, as an agency in that environment, we're not going to be, they decide our budget, the governor's our boss, we get a lot of our prioritization from them. But you don't see any JTA projects that are just for no reason. They're solving real problems, and we were a part of those discussions. So.
Thanks, Mark. Fred, before a member again, if you could indulge me another question. This one I know gets so complicated politically and geographically, it almost defies solution. But do you have any optimism at all that someday in the south part of the county there will be a connector or a system connecting 99 and I-5 in a way that will relieve some of the congestion in those four cities down there?
So as part of the OTO program, there was some funding provided for the I-5 and 99W connector project. And after much deliberation with many of the partners, it was decided that it wasn't the right way to go. There are certainly major impacts to the environment and, frankly, differences of opinion on where they wanted the traffic to go. So the OTO monies that were set aside for that project got moved on to other projects. One of the benefiting projects was the I-5 southbound, where we extended to 205 and added an auxiliary lane there. Some of the money went to that. But I can say that all the money stayed in Washington County. But just the timing wasn't right for that. There may be future discussions about a connector, but today it's off the table.
Thank you for being here. My name is Mark Mendelson. I'm a forum member. I'm not surprised, but somewhat dismayed to see that almost all of our discussion has turned to roads. And as Los Angeles has taught us, you cannot build roads and make your way out of congestion. I believe you said that too. What is ODOT doing in an attempt to inform the public that we need mass transit if we're going to make this area viable? And also, as a corollary to that, what part, if any, does ODOT have in land use planning so that more and more and more homes out in the western part of Washington County do not simply overload a system of roads that never will catch up with the traffic? And as fast as you build new roads, they'll build more homes and they'll build more traffic.
Yeah, so there are a couple of questions. I'm going to try to get them all, but you can yell at me. And I'll try to get the other ones. So I think the first one is, why are we talking so much about roads when there's a lot of other parts of the system? And think we've heard the voices from you and others that it's important to focus on land use. So we do have planning staff that work with local agencies on our transportation system plans. And another thing that's kind of newer, I think, to the agency are something we call interchange area management plans. So for these projects that David mentioned, we actually go through a process with the local governments to identify those adjacent land uses and make sure that the investments that we're making here are going to last, and then you're just going to blow up that interchange. So we do get involved in those. Now, we're not, our authority and role only goes so far. So but we work really well with our partners, I think, in those discussions. And if you want to add anything to that?
I think a good example of that is the Brookwood Interchange Project, where we're really making ramp improvements for the westbound to southbound. The UGB ends right there. There's no improvements to improve the capacity to the north part of that area. And so we do a lot of coordination with the cities and counties to ensure that our projects are very consistent with what the planning efforts are.
Is that it?
I think that's it. We appreciate what you guys have done and brought information to us, and we really, really thank you. As far as next week goes, we will have the fiscal status of TriMet and how they are dealing with it, and our speaker will be Neil McFarlane. And also remember, you have in front of you the map for May, for March and April. Please take a look at it. Make sure you remember. I'll remind you again next week. But meanwhile, I want to thank everyone for being here. Have an absolutely fabulous afternoon and evening. Thank you.